Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go. We are kingdom fellowship. We're kingdom focused. We gather to worship the Lord. So glad you chose to join us. Let's grow in the Word together. Give our heart to Jesus.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
We are kingdom.
We are kingdom fellowship. We're kingdom focused. We gather to worship the Lord.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go. We are kingdom fellowship. We're kingdom focused. We gather to worship the Lord.
Hallelujah, Jesus. There is no way I can live without you. Thank you, Father. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord for the power of his name and the grace of his presence. And welcome to another Tuesday night Bible study at Kingdom Fellowship AME Church. My name is Dr. Nicole Martin, and I am delighted to carry you through this brand new season as we consider what the truth of God's word is against the lies of the enemy. We are excited to have this time of worship with you, this time of digging into God's word. And we celebrate our pastor, Pastor Matthew Watley, for allowing us to have this space. This ministry is so critical for the developing of disciples, and we thank the Lord for the ways that we can connect, even online right now. So if you're joining us right now, if you're on Facebook or on YouTube or on some other medium, would you just let us know that you're here? Just say, I'm here. Glad to be here. Glad to be in the number. We are just so delighted to have this time of fellowship and community building and of study with you. And if this is your first time, or maybe you were invited by someone else, we welcome you. And now is a great time to share this with someone else. Let somebody know. Join me in Bible study. Well, all the barriers of inviting people to Bible study are broken down. Now you can invite someone. You don't have to worry about where they're going to park or waiting for them when they arrive or saving a seat. We can share God's word right where we are. And we are so, so blessed to do so. Well, let's dig into the word of God tonight. And before we do so, I'm going to open us up in a word of prayer. We're going to go through our Bible study at the end. We'll have an opportunity to talk about how you can join our church, how God might prompt you to participate in worship, and we'll prepare ourselves for all that the Lord has in store for us. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for the worship that's gone before us. Thank you for the power and the study of your word. We pray that you would be with us right now. That somebody is tuning in and may feel like they're on their last straw, may feel like they're at the end of their rope. And so I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would minister directly to that person. For someone else, God, they may be watching because of grief or watching out of depression or anxiety or stress. And I just pray, Holy Spirit, that you would minister to that individual now. And for all of those, God, who are joining in right now, joining in, trying to listen, to grow, to be better disciples, God, help us all to grow so that as we dig into your word, you would prove how living and how active your word really is. So let your word come alive tonight as we study. Let your word come alive in our hearts. And we thank you, Lord, for the harvest that will come from this time together. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. Well, we've got a wonderful time here. We're doing this series, Truth Over Lies. And as we think about what God's word is, we have to think about where the lie comes from. For the past 2 weeks, we've shared this anchor scripture, and I want to share it with you once again. This is John chapter 8, verse 44. This is Jesus speaking to the religious, the religious and pious people of the time, the Sadducees and the Pharisees. But I don't want to just categorize it as these two groups. Jesus is speaking directly to those who think they have power over God, to those who think they have power over the gospel, over the word of God. And to them, Jesus reminds them of what a lie really is. He says in John 8, verse 44, you belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Again, this context is so important because, you know, part of the challenge of understanding and unpacking the lies in our lives is we don't always remember where lies come from. Lies do not come from God. God is incapable of lying. Lies don't always come from ourselves, even though we know we can be our own worst enemies. But Satan, the devil, is the father of lies. So when the lie comes in your mind, when the lie comes to you from people who are close to you, when the lie comes from all of these different places, we have to target the source and know this is the enemy. And what we're trying to do in this series is to develop a muscle of discernment so that when the thought comes in, when the words come to us, we'll be able to quickly identify this is a lie and then apply the truth of God's word over and against that lie. Just as we know scripture tells us that the weapons will be formed and will not prosper, we know the lies will come, but they will not prosper because we know God's truth. So with the framework of this anchor scripture from John chapter 8, we're going to go now to the beginning of all of the series of lies. And that's going to be Genesis chapter 3. It's important for us to unpack the beginning of how we start to see lies that kind of filter into humanity through the doorway of sin, so that we can, again, remember the text here and remember the goal. We want to be able to identify the lie and flex those muscles of God's truth over and against that lie. So here we have Genesis chapter 3. I'm going to be reading from verse 1 through 13, and then I'll come back on verse 21 through 24. But if you have the time, take the time to read all of Genesis 3. All of this context is important for us to understand, where did this all start, and how do we name it, and how do we apply the truth of God over what we know, over the lies that we know. So I'm going to start again, Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 in the New International Version. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die." "You will certainly not die," the serpent said. I'm going to read that again. "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Let's pause right there, because there is so much to unpack. I also want to let you know, I'm walking very gingerly and graciously into this text. Scholars have spent their lifetimes unpacking what is known here as the fall, unpacking the dynamics, unpacking what really happened. Theologians for 2,000 years have been trying to figure out this particular text. So much of our doctrine of sin and our doctrine of humanity is based on this very text. So I'm walking in gently. I'm encouraging you to do your research, to study God's word. And as we walk through together, it's almost like we're walking through a wooded area trying to see the deer that may come out. And if anybody knows, when you walk into a wooded area and you want to see a deer, you don't come charging in, you don't rampage in with flashing lights and loud noise. You walk gently in, careful not to disturb the ecosystem, careful not to make too much noise. And then you stand and you wait to see the animals, the deer that may emerge. Friends, tonight, I feel like as we walk into Genesis 3, we're walking softly into the ecosystem of the Garden of Eden, trying to listen in on what's taking place, holding our breath just slightly so that we won't upset the things that God is about to do, recognizing that there's something here that we've got to pay attention to. So as we're walking together, journeying into this forest of God's word, what do you hear? What do you see? Where are the lies? Well, one of the things that we notice as we're walking slowly through this text, we start to see the very first lie. And the very first lie is in verse 1. Did God really say that? Did God really say that? Now look at verse 1. Verse 1 again, I'm going to read it again. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals that the Lord has made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from the tree in the garden and from any tree in the garden?" As we kind of figure out this lie here, you see the tactic of the serpent at the first onset of sin is to plant a seed of doubt that would cause a behavior that would go against what God has said. I'm going to repeat that again. The tactic of the enemy is to plant a seed of doubt that would cause you to question and then eventually go against what God has said. by bearing this question, did God really say the serpent is planting a seed of doubt, a seed of questioning? He is inserting right now this wrestling that still presents itself in our hearts and minds today, that the question of, did God really say that? It is a question of interpretation. It is a question of hearing. It is a question of going back and really thinking, well, did I really hear accurately? Don't you hear the enemy tempting and testing with lies in this genre today? Don't you hear the enemy questioning? I mean, did God really say the tattoos are wrong? Did God really say that it was wrong to drink? Did God really say that you shouldn't step out on your wife? Did God really say that? And no matter how obvious the lie is, or even no matter what comes next after did God really say, what the tactic of the enemy in this particular part is to plant a seed of doubt, to plant a seed of doubt that would cause you to question something, that would cause you to take an action that would go against what God really said. I was talking to a woman who has an organization, and they help to prepare people to have good, insightful dialogues about politics. And, you know, she was talking about how do you have civil discourse when you have differing views politically. So I asked her the question, what do you do when you're talking to someone who has a very staunch political view that is very different from your own? How in the world can you help people understand a perspective when they seem so entrenched in what they believe that they just won't listen? She said the key to good discourse is not to contradict what someone said. It is to provoke doubt in what they think they believe. So here you have political discourse that is framed around the idea not of a contradicting truth or a contradicting reality, but it's framed on the very reality that if you can provoke doubt, then you can lead the conversation, the story, in another direction. Even lawyers do this. When juries are pulled together, the question is, are you able to make an agreement or make a statement or come to an agreement without any reasonable doubt? What the devil does here is he inserts this seed of doubt, and doubt will lead its way down that slippery slope of disbelief. Did God really say? And then here's the thing. He's asking a question, but he's framing it just barely above the truth so that if you weren't quite sure what God said, then it would be a cause to question everything that God said. Now, in order for us to really understand the significance of this first lie, we have to go right now to Genesis chapter 2. Our study right now, we're going to move to Genesis chapter 2, because in order for us to understand the gravity of what Satan is trying to do through the serpent, we've got to know what God really did say. So this is Genesis chapter 2, and God is speaking to the man. This is Genesis chapter 2. I'm going to start at verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and care for it. And the Lord commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will certainly die." Now let's pause right there. What did God really say? If I'm reading the text correctly, what God said is you can eat from every tree in the garden. There's only one tree that I forbid. And the reason I forbid it is clear. Verse 17, "But you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die." So the lie of the enemy provokes a seed of doubt, of question about what God really said. Now, many theologians have speculated the reason why this lie was palpable for Eve. Some have speculated that she didn't hear directly from God when he told Adam what to do, because it's not until after God gives this command of which trees to eat from and which trees not to eat from that Eve is developed, is formed from Adam's rib. So some theologians suspect, maybe Eve is questioning what she heard because she didn't hear it. Maybe Eve is questioning because she heard it from Adam. Some theologians suspect that maybe it was like the telephone line. You remember the telephone game where one person would tell a secret to another person, would tell a secret to another person. By the time it got back to the original person, it wasn't the same thing at all. In fact, it was something totally different. So some suspect that God told Adam, and then after Eve was formed, Adam told Eve. And so by the time the serpent had a conversation with her, some theologians say he was going for the weakest link, because by the time he reached Eve, he knew that he was talking to someone who didn't hear the command firsthand. Other theologians say that after Eve was born, God spoke again. And because it's not clear in the text, perhaps it's not something we should hang our hats on for this particular point. But what is clear in the text is the first lie comes with the inception of doubt. Here's the serpent in verse 1, Genesis 3. Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? And technically, Eve could have come back and said, right now, I'm recognizing a lie. She could have said, this is a lie. How did she know it was a lie? Well, first of all, because God didn't say you must not eat from any tree. God said you can eat from every tree except. And she goes on to explain that in her own version. But before we move too quickly on Eve's response, we need to hang out here, because the same lie of the enemy, did God really say, fill in the blank, is the same tactic that he uses today. And how do we know that this is a tactic of the enemy? Because we are not as good about studying the fullness of God's word. And because we have gaps in our own understanding of God's word, the enemy is still able to use this tiny, tiny seed of doubt to provoke question about what God says. I know right now, probably while I'm speaking, the enemy is saying to somebody, yeah, but did God really say that? Right now, as I'm speaking, the enemy has said to somebody, yeah, but did God really say you can't have a little bit more? I mean, but did God really say that you can't sleep together? Or did God really say that cohabitation is wrong? When I was leading young adults and singles ministry, I would get the question all the time about cohabitation, or about, you know, tattoos, or about drunkenness, or about smoking weed. And what people are looking for is a specific verse in scripture that says a specific thing that would forbid them from doing some modern derivative of what has always been. And every time the question would come, the question was looking for validation of something that they knew deep down God didn't want them to do. And so here's the enemy. I mean, did God really say that? I mean, is there an actual scripture that says you shouldn't do this very thing? Is there an actual scripture that says this? And here comes the enemy. The enemy is able to deceive us when he can provoke a doubt about what God says. But here's the reality. Here's the truth of God's word. God's word is clear, period. God's word is true, period. And when you read the fullness of God's word, then you don't have to needle for the one specific thing that you want validated. You can get the context of God's heart, and you can recognize God's truth even when it doesn't speak directly to your situation. So as you're reading the fullness of God's word, what you get is the heartbeat of God. What you get is the truth of God. And then you move, as you grow with God, from looking for the specific validation of your question, which is what the enemy wants you to do, and move from that to getting the fullness of God's heart and God's perspective. Because when you get the fullness of God's heart and God's perspective, only then can you interpret God's truth. So the first lie that we're unpacking right now is this lie that comes from, did God really say? And here's the enemy. Here's the lie. You must not eat from any tree in the garden. We know from Genesis 2, specifically from Genesis 2:17, that God didn't say that. So let's go on down and let's continue to unpack the lie. In verse 2, Genesis 3, verse 2, the woman said to the serpent, We may eat the fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. So our first lie right now is, did God really say that? And the second one is unpacking right here. It's unpacking right here because here we have Eve is trying to discern the truth of God. And I'm one that does not blame Eve. Sin affects all of humanity, enters the world through the first humanity, Adam and Eve. And so Eve may have been sharing back what she thought she heard. Remember, it could have been the telephone game. It could have been her misinterpretation. It could have been a number of things, but for whatever reason, what Eve is repeating back to the serpent is not what God said. So here in Genesis 3, we're going to keep going. She's saying we can eat from any fruit in the garden, and which is true. And then God says you can't eat from the tree that's in the middle of the garden. Now she's getting a little loose. Was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the middle of the garden? Were there other trees around that garden? Some theologians suggest that the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was so apparent that you couldn't mistake it with the other trees. Some theologians suggest it was a tree up on a hill, that it had shining around it, that God made this tree so very clear that if there was any question about which of the trees was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they would have known. And so perhaps Eve wasn't lying. Perhaps it was true that this very tree, the one that was forbidden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, was in the middle of the garden. Perhaps it was true. But then we see a little bit more. Eve is saying you can't touch it. And again, maybe this is Eve's interpretation. Maybe in her mind, when she heard don't eat from it, she also knew, well, then I shouldn't touch it. I shouldn't be near it. I shouldn't look at it too hard. I shouldn't desire it. But then she got the last part correctly, or you will die. Now, here's the second lie of the enemy. The first lie of the enemy comes in. Did God really say, and you can't eat from any tree? He tries to prohibit the gospel. But here's the second lie in verse 4. You will not certainly die. Oh, friends, you know, as we go through these lies of the enemy, I can't help but grieve because I know that these same lies are being spoken in our lives right now. What the enemy tries to do, his tactic first is to provoke some doubt, get you wavering, get you second guessing the truth, get you second guessing. Well, I mean, God did say that, but I think he said the middle. And well, God did say all trees, but he did say it was that one tree. And I can't remember if it was eating from the tree or eating and touching it. So here his tactic is working. Eve is may have been questioning, you know, the doubt is working in. But the second lie is major because he tries to minimize the consequence. He says, you will not surely die. And whenever the enemy speaks lies to us, he tries to minimize the consequence of belief. He tries to minimize what would happen if we believe it. And so in this text, he's saying, you will not certainly die. Surely God must not have meant what he said. In our lives, it shows up like it's not all that bad. It's just a white lie. It's just changing one word or one date on a form. It's just another zero. It's just fill in the blank. Even now, the lie of the enemy shows up in our lives by minimizing the truth of God's word, by minimizing consequence. As Christians today, we are faced with so many options. You know, there was a time when some would say life was black and white. It was either good or it was bad. It was either obvious or it wasn't. But now we're in a time of gray space, of gray area. Now there are so many decisions that we have to make every single day. Decisions about what to post on social media. Decisions about what we eat. Decisions about whether or not we cheat on a diet. Decisions about how we have relationships with other people, decisions about how much to share, how far to go, how much is too much. Every day, it seems like we're always deciding how far to go. Where is the line, God? And human nature pushes us to say, well, how far can I get to the line without crossing over? We're always trying to approach the fringe. We're always trying to approach the boundaries. And the enemy knows that our nature, our tendency is to come close to the fence, as close as we possibly can. And just when we're right there, he likes to sneak in and say, the consequence won't be so bad. Crossing that line is not going to kill you. No one ever died because they did this, or no one ever shriveled up because they crossed this line. I mean, think about it. Besides Uzzah, who touched the ark, you know, and died on the spot, besides Old Testament scripture, who do you know that sinned against God and died on the spot? You will not certainly die. Can't you hear the voice of the enemy speaking? Can't you name the times in your life where the enemy has tried to minimize the consequence? Oh God, have mercy upon us. I can see this image of going close to the fence, like children going just close enough to the fence and looking around. Why do we do that? When we know we're about to cross a line, when we know we're about to sin, why is it that we check over our shoulders as if God doesn't see, as if God seeing us is not enough? I would say to you, the reason why this lie worked for Eve, and the reason why this lie works for many of us, is because the devil, once he plants the seed of doubt, the next step, the next logical step, is to minimize consequence. You're not going to die. Nothing will happen to you. And I want you to know that God's word is true. If there's anything that we're learning right here, if you forget every single thing that I've said, I want you to remember this. The word of God is true. And while you may not see the consequence right now, while the consequence may not lead to an immediate death right now, you can be assured that God never lies. And while the enemy tells you that God is going to go against his word and the consequence is not real, I want you to know that God's word is true and there are always consequences for the sins that we do. If we were in a room together, I'd say, is there a witness? Is there anybody who knows that just when the enemy tried to minimize the consequence and you crossed the line, you recognized almost immediately what you had done? I wish I had a witness of somebody who wasn't ashamed to say, I crossed the line and I suffered the consequence and I recognized almost immediately the regret that I had. I recognized the moment that the enemy spoke the lie and minimized the consequence. I recognized the moment that I crossed the line and I knew in my spirit, or I knew in my mind, or I saw later on that God doesn't lie and there really are consequences for the sins that we have. And so here we want to keep walking through this text. We see that the first lie comes in, did God really say? It is a questioning of what God really said. The second lie comes in the minimizing of truth. You will not certainly die. But then there's a third lie. There's a third lie that happens here. And this is the more subtle lie. This, I think, is the lie for any Christian who's been walking with God for a little bit of time, or anybody who sees themselves as being mature in the faith. This lie happens in verse 5. So let's backtrack to verse 4. You will not certainly die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Now look at what the enemy says in verse 5. For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God. Now, let's look again at Genesis chapter 2. We're going back to Genesis chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work and care for it. And the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will certainly die. Now, here is one of the more astute attacks of the enemy. In this little lie that he introduced in Genesis 3:5, he is using the word of God out of context. The enemy likes to lie to us sometimes by using God's word out of context. Now, what was the proper context of the word of God? Well, the proper context of the word of God was in God's protection. Adam, you can eat from any tree. He's giving freedom. He's giving liberty. He's giving grace. Eat from any tree. God is saying to Adam, I want you to not just go ahead and be okay eating from it, but I want you to enjoy the mangoes, enjoy the bananas, enjoy the oranges and the grapes, and enjoy the fruit from these trees. I want you to feast on them, enjoy them. And the enemy tries to step in with that first lie by restricting what God has given freedom to. He tries to restrict what God has permitted. But in this particular lie, this lie taken out of context, God says to Adam, as we just read in Genesis 2, don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Why? For when you eat from it, you'll certainly die. Now, did God say, when you eat from it, you'll become like me? Did God say, when you eat from it, you'll start to know things and it'll start to bother you and wake you up at night? No, that is not what the Bible says that God said. God simply said, don't eat from that tree, or you will die. God did not enumerate. He did not elaborate. He did not expand the definition. He simply said, don't eat from it or you'll die. But look at the enemy. Look at what the enemy did. Chapter 3, he tries to break it down and expand on it, take God's word out of context and expand on it. He says, for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Here's the tactic of the enemy. We know from later Old Testament texts and from various accounts that Satan was banished from the heavens because he was trying to be like God. It is the enemy's desire to be worshiped. It is the enemy's desire to have your allegiance. The enemy's desire is to reign and to rule and to overtake and to have all power. And so part of this lie taken out of context is the enemy tries to tell you what he knows about God. And isn't it crazy when you think about it? Why would Satan try to tell me what he knows about God? Why would what Satan thinks he knows about God be meaningful in any way to me? But look at how he frames it. For God knows. And I want to say to those of you who are mature believers, for those of you who've been walking with God for a long time, be careful not to take the word of God out of context. Be careful to read the full heart of God, to read the full text of the word of God. Be careful to get the fullness of what God is saying so that you might not fall into the place where the devil can lie to you and try to take God's word and use it against you. I remember, well, now I guess it was almost 20 years ago. My goodness, almost 20 years ago, I was speaking with Bishop Alexander, who was my pastor when I first got started in ministry. And he said, one of the best things that preachers can do is to read the Word of God. And he began to talk about his habit of reading through the Bible every single year. Well, I tried that for a few years and, true confession, it took me 3 years to do my very first one, but I did it. And I realized that there's something really beautiful that happens when we read all of God's word all the time. When you're doing the verse a day, when you're doing a certain scripture that you like, even a portion of the psalm, and you're doing the Bible roulette, you're either like skimming through and trying to look at something that's going to encourage you for the moment, or maybe you're doing the Bible prescriptions where you say, okay, my pain is loneliness, so let me find a Bible verse that will be a prescription for my pain. When you do that, you miss the context. You miss the fullness of what God is saying. You miss the full plan. But when you read the fullness of the Bible, then you get context and you're able to recognize when the enemy tries to speak to you and take God's word out of that context. So here the devil is trying to say, well, you know the reason why God doesn't want you to eat from that. I mean, I'll tell you, if you're waiting for the truth, let me give you the truth. The reason why God doesn't want you to eat from that is because when you do, you're going to be like him and you'll know all the good and all the evil. Well, as I said last week, part of the issue with a lie is lies are only effective when they seem like they have a tiny bit of truth. Now, what could that tiny bit of truth be? It could have been that the devil wasn't all that wrong in saying that if we eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, we would start to know good and evil. That's not altogether untrue. This is, you know, yeah, that's a small part that is actually true. If you eat from this tree, you will know good and evil. But here's the lie. The devil takes it completely out of context. He says, when you eat from that tree, God knows that you will be like him. And here are the layers. God is threatened by you. God doesn't want you to be like him. God doesn't want you to succeed. God doesn't want you to be powerful. God doesn't want you to know or to grow. God wants to keep you bound. He wants to keep you caged. He doesn't want you to experience the fullness. And with these three lies, the devil gets Eve to take of the fruit, to eat of the fruit, and to plunge us all through her and through Adam and Eve, through the sins of both. The devil was able to get us to plunge into generations of sin, into hardship, into chaos, into pain, into labor, just from these three lies. And the same enemy that was at work in Genesis 3 is the same enemy trying to work in our lives today. And I want you to know, my brother, my sister, that we've got to be astute enough to recognize the lies. And next week, when we come back, we're going to go through the same verse. We're going to go through these same scriptures because I need to help us unpack the truth. And this is not just any truth that God gives in contrary to all of these lies. The truth of this text comes in God's redemption. And for every one of these lies, God brings redemption. But as we go through this week, as we go through right now, I want you to pause and begin to think about the ways that these very lies have been active in your life. Think about the times when God started, when Satan tried to infuse doubt. Has he done that already? Maybe that happened today. Did God really say that I was going to succeed? Did God really say that everything was going to be all right? Everything? Did God really say that I'd be healed? Did God really say that I would make it through? Through these little doubts, this is where the lie of the enemy has tried to move you by getting you to question what God said. I want you to think now about every one of those things. Have you thought about him? Once you get those lies in your mind, I want you to right now in your mind, visualize and actualize God's truth over it for every one of those. Did God really say, yes, God's word is true? Did God really say, yes, God never lies? Did God really say I'd be successful? Yes, God said I was more than a conqueror through him who loves me. Did God really say I'd make it over? Yes, God said in this world you will have trouble, but fear not, I've overcome the world. Did God really say that I'd be healed? Yes, God said by his stripes you are healed. For every one of the did God said, I want you right now, actualize, visualize God's word slashing through the lies. And then look at that second lie. Not only did God really say, but look at that second lie. You will not surely die, minimizing the consequence. I know it's a sobering thing to do. I know it's not easy to recognize. I know that there are parts of us that don't want to believe that God would punish us in any way. But I want you to think now about all the times that the devil tried to lie to you by minimizing consequence. If you go that far, nobody will know. If you take that step, no one will care. If you happen to lie a little bit, it's not ever that bad. Minimizing it by crowdsourcing it. You know, such and such did the same thing and nothing happened to them. You know, this has been going on for centuries and nothing happened to all those people. I want you to start realizing it, recounting it. Do you have those times in your mind? They're different for all of us, but they're still the same lie. And once you get that in your mind, I want you to visualize the word of God, the sword of the Spirit slashing through those lies. Yes, God said it and God meant it. Yes, God will give me courage to stand firm and not succumb to the lies of the enemy. Yes, I know that I'm tempted, but God's word will give me strength to fight against temptation. Yes, I know that I'm weak and I can cross the line, but God will give me strength so that he won't allow me to cross the line. God will give me strength and courage to stand up against what the enemy is saying I can and should do. I know, God, that I'm tempted, but God, help me in my weaknesses. Help me in my temptations. Help me because I can't do it by myself. Help me because I know that if I'm left to my own devices, I will cross the line. But God, I come against the lie of the enemy because I know your word is true. God, keep me from the consequences that are promised in your word. And then look at that third lie. That third lie, the first, of course, is, did God really say? The second is minimizing consequence, you won't surely die. And then the third is taking God's word out of consequence, for God knows. And right now, I want you to start thinking in your mind all of the times when the enemy tried to take God's word out of context. Didn't God say that your foot won't be dashed against the stone, but didn't you hurt yourself that time? I know God said that you would, you know, be the head and not the tail, but aren't you pretty much last place right now? I know God said that you'd be covered, but I mean, it doesn't take a genius to know that you're pretty exposed, pretty vulnerable right now. The enemy right now trying to take God's word out of context. But we say to the devil, like Jesus said to the devil in his temptation, you shall not test the word. You shall not put the Lord your God to the test. You shall not tempt the Lord your God. And for every time, I hope you got it in your mind. I hope you've got those things in your mind, those things that the enemy tried to take God's word and turn it against you. For every one of the times when the enemy tried to take God's word out of context, we visualize and we actualize the word of God slashing through the lie, slashing through the lie, slashing through the poor context, slashing through this idea that God is threatened by us, or that God is intimidated by us, or that God doesn't want us to succeed. For every lie of the enemy, we've got an answer in God's word, because God's word says, I will exalt you and I will lift you up. God's word says, I will make you the head and not the tail. God's word says, even though the weapons are formed, they will not prosper. God's word says, I am for you and not against you. And every time the enemy tries to lie to us and get us to believe this ridiculous idea that God doesn't want us to be happy, to have peace, to be successful, we come against it with the truth. And the truth is that the Lord our God is with us, that the Lord will never leave or forsake us, that the Lord will lift us up in due time, and that we will never be put to shame. I don't know where you are or who you are or what you've been wrestling with, but I know for a fact that the enemy is still lying to us. And I also know that for every one of the enemy's lies, we have the truth of God's word. And next week, we're going to unpack more of this truth, more of God's redemption, because we need to recognize that the devil is a liar. He cannot speak the truth. He is the father of lies. And as John 8:44 tells us, lying is his native language. But we come against that with the native language of the truth of God. We come against the enemy right now with the truth of God. Lord, thank you so much. Thank you, Lord, just for the power of your word. Thank you for reminding us to point out the lies, lies that cause us to question your word, lies that cause us to minimize the consequence, lies that cause us to doubt your pure intentions toward us, that cause us to take your word out of context. We come against the enemy right now in the name of Jesus. And we thank you, God, for the power of your word. We thank you, Lord, for not hiding the lies, but revealing them and bringing them to light. And we pray, Lord, that you will continue this week to shine the light of your truth on every single lie. Shine the light of your truth on every lie the enemy speaks. And we thank you, God, that the more we lean on your truth, the more we'll start to see your light. The more we lean on your truth is the more we'll start to see the freedom that you intended. God, thank you that the more we lean into the truth of your word, it's the more we'll start to feel the freedom of your gospel, the freedom, God, that you set in place, that those who are in Christ are free indeed. God, help us to lean into the truth and not be bound by the lies. Help us not to worry about what the enemy says, but help us to lean into your truth that says your grace is sufficient, your truth that says that all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord, your truth that says we are more than conquerors, your truth that says that nothing separates us from you. And God, as we lean into your truth, help us not to hoard it, but to give it freely. Help us to share your truth freely for others who may be struggling and suffering and want to know who you are. And for God, those who are listening and watching who want to know who you are, help them to know who Christ is today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. If you've been tracking along with this, maybe you felt a kind of move of the Holy Spirit, a perking of the Holy Spirit in your heart. And maybe you've started to realize that you need to accept God's truth, the ultimate truth, that Christ came to save and redeem us and that Christ came to set us free. If that's you, God reminds us in Romans that we don't have to be perfect. All we have to do is confess with our mouths that Jesus is Lord. Believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead and we will be saved. So if you're watching and you've not made that declaration, you're not sure of your salvation, make that confession today. Accept Christ as your personal savior. Maybe you've been kind of watching, but you haven't joined a church. Now is the time. Nothing is keeping you from becoming a member of Kingdom Fellowship Church or whatever local church is near you. Become a part of the body of Christ. And as you make that decision, or even if you're thinking about making that decision, let us know. Just text fresh start to 313131. Text new start. I believe it is new start. Text new start to 313131. And we would love to journey with you. The moment you send that text, someone from our Connect Coach team is going to connect with you to let you know you're not by yourself, to welcome you into the body of Christ, to answer questions as you may have them, and to guide you closer to the truth of God's word. And if you've been blessed by our time today, you know that this time of worship comes as a gift from God's church to each of you. And part of our response to the gospel is to give. There are so many ways that you can give. It's up on the screen right now. You can give in whatever way you feel comfortable and led. But if you've been fed, if you've been blessed, won't you give today? Giving is not an obligation. It is a gift, for God loves a cheerful giver. We give because we know God is worth it, because we know that he is good, and because we want to see the flourishing of God's church. So thank you for those of you who have given, for those of you who give your tithes on Sundays. Thank you for those of you who are giving today. We pray that this is not your only encounter with Kingdom Fellowship Church. Join us again. We've got the replay on Wednesdays of our Sunday morning service. Join us again on Sunday as we worship God in truth with our Sunday morning service. And then come back next Tuesday as we continue unpacking God's truth over the lie. God bless you. God bless you, and have a great rest of your day.